Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Online course on Introduction to Modern Western Art, Movements and Artists. This is the fourth week, and the first lecture is dedicated to the understanding of abstract painting. And in this lecture, besides discussing briefly the concept and nature of abstract painting, we will be also looking at a few specific examples of abstract paintings by a selected number of very famous painters like Picasso, Klee, and Mondrian. Now, as we have seen, that along with Cubism, a new form of picture making came into being in very early part of the 20th century. And we have seen that in those paintings, they carry very less suggestion or no suggestion at all of any figurative or representational hint. It is in this sense that in these kind of paintings, we fail to identify any particular object or figure within the painting. And as such, these paintings are, generally speaking, known as non-representational paintings, which is another name for abstract painting. So, what we witness here is a gradual disappearance of any clue to identify any object or figure within a painting, and that compels the viewers to consider the possibilities of abstract art. That is, it is not possible, as it has been understood from the early part of the 20th century. It is now possible to have a work of art, to do a work of art, to encounter a work of art, whether in painting or sculpture, which may not have any recognizable trait or clue at all. And that work of art will mainly consist of very fundamental basic visual elements like line, color, form, shape, composition, that is in case of painting. And in case of sculpture, we will be encountering shapes, rhythms, geometry, mass, volume, etc. So, when you look at one very early example of abstract painting, which was a result of Cubism, for example, the painting called Ma Jolie, painted by Pablo Picasso in 1911. This painting is a clear indication of this hitherto unknown tendency. Though in this painting, you may still feel tempted to identify certain portions, maybe, of a few objects. But by and large, as you keep looking at this painting, or any painting of this kind, made by Picasso or Braque in the wake of Cubism, you will see that how the forms gradually tend to lose their figurative identity and become independent entity. So that is the crux of the issue, that abstract painting eventually gives rise to independent entity of forms. Independent of any recognition, independent of any identity, independent of any objective reference to the factual world. Look at this painting called The Accordionist, once again by Picasso, painted in 1911. Again, though the title suggests a real life subject matter, the painting is not surreal. I mean, the forms do not lend themselves to an easy recognition or identification of the figure or the object or anything that is related to the subject matter. What we see here, as we have observed before, is a conglomeration, a strange combination of various lines, shapes, angles, triangles, intersecting each other at various points and thereby forming a strange visual composition. And same happens with another painting painted in 1911 again called The Portuguese, and this time it is by George Braque, the fellow cubist of Picasso. And he, in the wake of cubism, was also following the same path, a kind of gradual progression towards abstraction. And though abstraction itself was not their goal, but cubists gradually happened to be and happened to have emerged as the first group of painters to have strongly not only conceptualized but also executed abstract paintings. And almost at the same time, Casimir Malevich in 1930 created this painting called The Black Circle, in which he went one step further and got rid of any faintest hint of the objective world. This is again, I would say, a kind of very hardcore abstract painting. At least in case of the paintings done by Picasso or Braque, though very remote, very faint, yet one could sense a shadow presence of some objective world. But in case of a painting like this, called The Black Circle by Malevich, painted at the same time in 1913, there is absolutely no reference to the objective experiential world. The entire painting is based on a certain understanding of shape, composition, in this case, the very placement of the black circle shifted slightly towards upper right within the white square is the subject, is the theme of the painting, if I may allow to say so. One more painting by Malevich. Here again, what you see is simply the relationship between geometric shapes without having any reference to the experiential, real, or human world. Draw art around the same time, as a part of the Dadaist movement, and he later also joined the Surrealist movement, was also coming up with the strange compositions where once again you do not see anything that is a part of your known world or experiential world. It's all about shapes, and moreover, in case of genre, it is also not a very predetermined arrangement of shapes, but he was also giving chance a role to play in determining the composition. An element of accident, an element of unpredictable moments. So this is possible with abstract art. Now we also have Lyubov Popova, another Russian artist who worked simultaneously at the same time with Malevich, and he was also a part of the constructivist movement. He was also coming up with paintings which straight away dealt with geometric entities and shapes and forms. There is nothing human or objective or representational about them. And slowly, these painters were paving the path for a long kind of movement or an engagement with abstract art or abstraction for the artists to follow. For example, a very famous Dutch artist called Piet Mondrian. Now, when you look at painting by Mondrian, one of his very famous well-known paintings like this, what you see is, again, a great kind of composition which almost reminds you of a modern house or a building or window frames, having a few squares neatly colored with one solid pigment. Next is all about verticals and horizontals. You create Mondrian, and then you have somebody like Paul Klee, who was deeply lyrical in his approach to the world that he was painting. But many of his paintings did not have any real life flow, like this one. What you see is a composition of small little color tiles or cubes. But whereas the constructivist paintings, like the one that you have seen by Malevich, was straight away derived from the idea of geometry and calculation, Paul Klee's paintings, although the paintings by their appearance are very abstract, that is, completely detached from the real world, Paul Klee's source of his paintings are not so abstract. That is why I said, right at the outset, that Paul Klee had a lyrical engagement with his surroundings, with nature, with what he observed. And then he transformed his experiences into a visual pattern, which happened to be abstract. And then, of course, you have several others whom we have already mentioned, like Malevich and Popova. But then when you look at their timeline, you will see that almost all of them were born more or less very close to each other, which implies that they lived and walked at the same time, which further implies that abstraction was quite an in-scene during the time when these artists and many others whom we are not mentioning right now were working. So basically, it was the early 20th century, during which abstract art, and not just abstract painting, both abstract painting and sculpture, the whole idea of making an abstract art without any reference to the real world caught the imagination of a number of artists. And then, even within the context of an entirely different movement, which we have already discussed in one of our previous lectures, that is German Expressionism, we have seen the work by Vasily Kandinsky, who, despite his deep association with German Expressionist movement, which was more of a kind of a social movement, an art movement that was deeply concerned with the immediate social and political reality. But Kandinsky was more paintings, not different. Many of his paintings are pretty abstract in nature, without having any direct political or social reference. And once again, he was doing this particular painting also in 1912. Now let us look at a few paintings by Paul Klee, where we get to see a strong presence of the possibility of abstract idiom, with, of course, how would you say, presence, but not very strong presence, okay, obvious, but muted and subdued presence of a real life. For example, a few lines suggesting the roof of a house, and maybe a shape that is suggesting a doorway into the house, or a small little orange sphere, perhaps signifying the sun. Now, when you look at this kind of painting by Paul Klee, you may ask that why do we call them abstract paintings? Because many of these paintings do have, though slightly oblique, but they do have a reference, they do have some kind of recognizable feature in their paintings, in their works of art, in their forms, in their shapes. So, how do you, and why do you call them abstract? Well, we call them abstract because, particularly Paul Klee's paintings, in spite of his off and on reference, and again the references to the real world, at least in his paintings, are not very, very strong. They are obvious, but they are subdued. Now, in spite of his references, his paintings look very abstract, and they are abstract because of an overwhelming presence of the idea that forms, colors, shapes, lines can also exist independently. So, on the one hand, there is a reference, a connect between his forms and the world out there. On the other hand, even if you like to be, you can always try to forget the references and focus mainly on the forms, and you are free to enjoy them. For example, in a painting like this by Paul Klee, you see that, of course, there are some graphic marks which resemble plants, flowers, and grass. But at the same time, there are long strips of horizontal lines of colors which do not directly represent anything. And so, as I was telling you, it is not an ambiguity that he was trying to create. He was rather trying to keep both simultaneously. But at the end of the day, whether you look at a drawing like this or the earlier paintings, what you see is an overwhelming presence of the abstract quality in this painting. In this painting, though the name is the title of the painting is quite poetic because it is called Fire in the Evening. But what you see in this painting is neither fire nor evening. But what you feel in this painting is both. So it's more than a visual reality that he's trying to explore in this painting. What warmth he's trying to explore in this kind of painting is a sensory reality, beyond the immediate visual reality. That is why in his paintings, the titles are extremely important. Because when you follow the title, you may not find the references in the painting as it is suggested by the title, but if you are looking at the painting with a sensitive eye, you are bound to feel what the title is suggesting, like this one. And we have the next brilliant abstract painter called P.H. Mondrian, who is famous for his grid-like abstract compositions, brightly colored, with an unmistakable clarity of shapes, squares, rectangles, horizontals, and verticals. In his paintings, it is possible to trace the process through which he arrived at this abstract. He is one such exceptional painter, in fact, P.H. Mondrian, who in several of his paintings has actually left behind the trajectory, the path that he travels in order to arrive at a pure abstract painting. For example, he begins with a painting like this, which is not at all abstract, because this particular painting has a very clear representation of an immediately recognizable form like a tree, which is not really the idea of a tree, it is the tree itself that has been represented in this painting. Let us look at the following painting by him, where he breaks down the form of a tree into several parts and fragments, and begins to reduce the recognizability bit by bit. In the third painting in the same series, the recognizability is almost gone. I mean, if you had not seen the tree before, nobody would be able to imagine that this form has been derived or has come out of the original form of a tree. It is absolutely difficult. Now that we have seen the first one, it is possible for us to see and follow the development. In fact, when you look at a painting like this, again, unless you are aware of this process, it is difficult to find the tree. Though, for somebody like Mondrian, it is very important to travel from the known to the unknown, from the recognition to the non-recognition, from representational to abstract. And finally, he arrives at a painting like this, where there is no trace of tree, no trace of any natural association between the artist and an object. This is absolutely an abstract painting composed of independent abstract elements like lines, meaning, and shapes, and a few curves and space, the most ambiguous entity in painting. For example, this one again. So, this is one brilliant example, and we are fortunate enough that Mondrian has left this example for us to know how, at least how he, this may not be a path to be followed by all the painters, but at least Mondrian followed this path and created his kind of abstract painting, that is, from the known to the unknown, from the real to the abstract. But not everybody would do that. There are a lot of abstract painters in the modern art. Somebody like, for example, Malevich, whose squares and circles kind of painting. So, straight to be derived from squares and circles. He did not have to start from the form of a real tree. But in case of Mondrian, the path was different. Now, this is a good example because the last thing, let us look at this particular painting by Mondrian called Sea and Sky, Sky, painted in 1915. Let us go into the details of this painting. Now, Mondrian's title for this drawing called Sea and Sky, Sky, it implies a landscape. As I was telling you, the title may imply something, but what we see and feel in the painting, that experience could be different. So it is not hard to imagine how the flat landscape of his native Holland, where sea, sky, and the land meet so seamlessly, might have inspired him. But he would soon abandon the use of such descriptive titles, choosing instead, as Malevich did, to use the term composition. So that was also one position that many abstract painters have taken, that to get rid of any descriptive title and use titles which are equally abstract. So, Klee and Sky features the artist's early experimentation with vertical and horizontal intersections. He saw this perpendicular relationship of the Cartesian X and Y axis as being essential to nature, as revealed in the intersection of trees and land. The element of Mondrian's work is quite distinct from Malevich's tilted view of the world. But like Malevich, Mondrian had begun to abandon the subject in favor of what he called pure, true form. And this brings us to a very, very fundamental understanding about abstract art as it has been understood by quite a few painters like Mondrian, that abstract art is quote-unquote pure art, quote-unquote true art. So, associating purity, truthfulness to abstract painting gave this form a tremendous justification and a foundation in the modern art. Because any kind of referentiality to the world outside with any painting meant, at least implied to some of them, that that particular work of art could not be understood as pure as an abstract painting. So, conceptually and philosophically, this is a very interesting position that abstract painting claimed to be the purest and the most truthful form of painting.